This video is brought to you by Mac Weldon, and you can get 20% off your first purchase. Just visit macweldon.com/brainfood20 and enter the promo code brainfood20. More on them in a bit. There are several different types of blood. Contained within them are different types of cells and countless molecules that give our bodies the needed nutrients to work effectively. The two main types of cells within the blood are red and white blood cells. Red blood cells make up nearly 45% of your blood volume. White blood cells make up less than 1%. So, what's left over? There's obviously a giant gap there, and well, that would be blood plasma, which makes up approximately 55% of your blood volume. As to blood types, what type you are will usually depend on the types of blood your parents have, though there can be exceptions, like if you receive a bone marrow transplant from someone with a different blood type, your blood type will eventually change, among other certain caveats like that. As to why there are different blood types, well, this isn't actually fully understood, though it's been observed that different blood types play a role in your susceptibility, or lack thereof, to certain diseases and conditions. For example, malaria seems to have been a major contributor to type O blood being a major thing in places like Africa, where about 51% of the populace have type O blood. As to why, it turns out for various reasons, type O blood will generally mean you won't get as sick if you get malaria. So that's a good thing. So, what are all the other blood types? And what's the whole positive and negative thingy about? Okay, so basically there are 8 main types of blood, and they're separated into 4 groups, with over 90% of people falling into one of these main groups. The groups are A, B, AB, and O. If you're wondering why O and not, for example, C, to make it ABC and nice and easy, well, it turns out that it was originally called C, but then it was later changed to the letter O in some regions or the number 0 in others. In both cases, this was to signify 0 or null. For reasons that we'll get into in a second, it wasn't just random. In any event, these blood types are grouped together by the presence or absence of what is known as an antigen. Antigens are the substances within the blood that basically cause our immune systems to create antibodies, which are essentially used to recognize invaders. These created antibodies then send anything the immune system thinks is a threat to sleep with the fishes. The specific antigens that create the different blood types are found on the surface of red blood cells and are known as type A and type B. They're further separated by the presence of another type of antigen known as Rh factor. If you have this Rh antigen present, you're considered a positive. If not, you're considered a negative Nancy, and nobody likes you. We're looking at you, Jimmy. Someone that has type A antigens and Rh factor is considered to have type A plus blood, the best grade of blood. And if you have both types of antigens and no Rh factor, then you have type AB negative blood. If you have no A or B antigens, then you are type O blood, hence the whole zero or null thing that was mentioned before. All of this matters because of those antibodies that your immune system creates. Someone with type A blood will at some point in their earliest months or years, for trigger reasons not really wholly understood, they'll develop antibodies for type B, and somebody with type B blood will have antibodies for type A. Type O has antibodies for both A and B. Okay, so let's actually answer the question of the video, shall we? This all brings us around to why mixing and matching certain, but not all, blood types in a person is a really bad idea. In a nutshell, if you were to give type B blood to someone who is type A, their antibodies for type A would attack the type A red blood cells, causing unwanted side effects, including, in the extreme, various things like kidney failure, as your kidneys try to filter out all of the destroyed red blood cells. It's not going to be a good time. And of course, regardless of this sort of thing, as you need sufficient blood to keep living, if your immune system destroys a high enough percentage of what you currently have in your body, well, it's not going to be a good time for you. But it's not always a bad idea to mix and match. For example, disregarding a bit of a caveat about atypical antibodies and things like that, someone with AB positive blood can actually receive blood from every other main blood type. As to why, if you've been following along, this is because these individuals are characterized by having both A and B antigens on their red blood cells, and thus cannot have either antibody in their plasma. For this reason, those with AB positive blood type are sometimes referred to as universal recipients because they can accept blood from anyone, again with the caveat about those atypical antibodies. However, the downside of this is that because of the presence of both antigens on type AB red blood cells, people with AB positive blood can only donate blood to others with the same type, and AB negative are only able to donate to AB positive or AB negative individuals, but are able to receive from any of the negative blood types, again with the aforementioned caveat, which we're just going to stop saying, but realize that it's a thing because the universe apparently hates simplicity. However, while AB blood type individuals can only donate blood to the same type, the reverse is true of plasma donations for them. This is because, again, AB individuals have neither A or B antibodies in their plasma. Thus, they are universal plasma donors. On the other end of the spectrum, type O, as noted, has neither A or B antigens on its red blood cells, but both A and B antibodies in its plasma. As a result, those with type O negative may donate to a person with every blood type but can only receive O negative blood since its plasma antibodies would attack anything else. This is why, along with the fact that only 7% of humans are O negative, those with the O negative persuasion are highly encouraged to donate blood often, first potentially for themselves, which is particularly handy to do regardless of blood type if you know you have a major surgery coming up, this gets around any shortage issue, as well as gets around any of the aforementioned potential compatibility caveats. The second reason O negative individuals are encouraged to donate often is, of course, because this can benefit most everyone. This is particularly the case when, in an emergency, there may not be time to figure out what blood type a person is, and thus if O negative is on hand, that can be reasonably safely used immediately, if absolutely necessary. Now, if you're wondering about the full list of main blood types and plasma compatibilities, we have these two charts where you'll note that they are more or less inverses of one another in terms of compatibilities between donor and recipient, for reasons previously explained. Moving on to white blood cells, there are six main types of white blood cells. They are neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, bands, monocytes, and lymphocytes. Each type plays a different role in the kind of infection your body is trying to fight. For example, neutrophils kill bacteria by ingesting them, called phagocytosis. Naturally, if you have a bacterial infection, the percentage of neutrophils within your blood would be elevated. On this note, in the general case, white blood cells number approximately 4 to 10,000 per microliter of blood. If their number is increased, then you probably have an infection that your body is trying to fight, and you're going to drop dead, well, any time now. Go ahead, we'll wait. Just be sure to click on autoplay. You dead yet, Jimmy? Excellent. As you might expect from this, when a doctor draws your blood to find out what's wrong with you, it's these high levels of white blood cells that will help them narrow down the cause of your problem. The last part of blood is the aforementioned plasma. This makes up most of your blood volume, and about 90% of plasma is simply water, with another 8% of plasma made up of proteins such as albumin, which helps move molecules like calcium and medications through your blood. It also helps move antibodies that help fight infection, and fibrinogen and clotting factors that help with the clotting of your blood, obviously. If you've been following the maths here, there's 2% left, and that contains hormones like insulin, electrolytes like sodium and potassium, and nutrients like sugars and vitamins. And just before we finish up here, one little tip from the paramedic author of this particular piece: how do you get blood stains out of clothes? I guess that was more useful for you, Scott. If you spill or otherwise get blood on your spilling blood, dude, whoops. If you spill or otherwise get blood on your clothes when Jimmy takes too long to die on his own, just soak it in 1 quart warm water, 2 teaspoons of laundry detergent, and 1 tablespoon of ammonia for approximately 15 minutes. Then remove all the ammonia and launder it normally. Are we creating a guide for how to clean up blood? And note, don't dry it until the stain is completely gone. Bam, your clothes will be blood-free, and the cops will never be able to link Jimmy's death to you. I don't want to like speculate about my murdering, but I'd definitely burn my clothes. It's like, oh yeah, well, I washed them real good. I'd be like, I'm pretty sure science is quite good. Maybe, I don't know. Burn those clothes. Speaking of getting blood out of your clothes, if you're going to rid the world of Jimmy, you might as well do it in style and appropriately. Look at this blood red jumper that Mac Weldon sent me. You can barely see the bloodstains. Mack Weldon is a premium men's essentials brand that believes in smart design and premium fabrics and absolutely do not endorse murder. They have this simple mission: make all your basics and beyond better designed and easier to shop for. Now, you've heard me talk about Mack Weldon before. Last summer, I wore their antimicrobial silver t-shirt for 8 days straight in the height of summer, and it did not smell after those 8 days. If you'd like to see that happen again, it probably won't happen again, but follow me on Twitter anyway, at Simon Whistler. But that was just one of the many highlights of getting your clothes from Mack Weldon. I wear their radius pants, which are these sort of trousers, as we call them in the UK, which are just, they look smart, but they're incredibly comfortable. I wear those most days, but you won't know that because you don't think I have legs. Mack Weldon sent me some more of their stuff. There's obviously this jumper that I'm wearing right now. Also, they sent me this little bag, and in this bag, there are two of their undershirts, which are amazing. They don't have this in the ad copy, but one of the greatest things about these is they stay tucked in. Like, I've bought cheaper ones of these from the high street, and the biggest thing is, like, I'll be wearing a jumper, and the next thing I know, the t-shirt's, like, rolling up to here. These guys stay tucked in. You get two in a bag, and then if I've, like, done a bit of a workout at work or something, I just tuck them right back in here. Normally one at a time. I don't change my t-shirt halfway through a workout. That'd be weird. Zip it up like that. Send it home for laundry. They've also got a loyalty program, by the way, called Weldon Blue. So once you've bought $200 worth of stuff, you'll get 20% off all further orders for an entire year. Plus, you get access to new stuff before anyone else. Plus, you get free gifts with your orders. Look, I love all of this stuff. The thing is, it's just better. Like I said, I used to buy undershirts, underwear from, like, cheap high street stores, thinking, eh, people can't see them, what's the difference? There is a difference. It just feels better. It's way more comfortable. It stays tucked in. You don't get a wedgie. It's just better. You can get 20% off your first order. Just go to macweldon.com/brainfood.
20.
Enter the promo code brainfood.
20.
You will love it. Bonus facts. Speaking of blood, a commonly touted idea is that deoxygenated blood turns blue. It turns out, however, this isn't true at all. The misconception that blood that lacks oxygen turns blue probably comes from the fact that veins appear blue and blood in the veins is typically heading back to the lungs. Hence, it would be depleted of oxygen and people are like, oh yeah, it's blue, okay. It's also possibly from the fact that when people are suffocating or the like, their lips and complexion seem to turn bluish or purple. As to why veins often appear blue in those of the fairer-skinned persuasion, this simply has to do with the fact that they are very close to the surface of the skin, combined with the way that light diffuses in the skin of certain shades. More specifically, veins may appear blue in some people from the way subcutaneous fat absorbs low-frequency light. This permits only high-frequency blue and violet wavelengths to penetrate through the skin to the vein. Wow, that's complicated. With the other wavelengths getting filtered off from the pigmentation of your skin. In fact, when skin is removed, God, such as when dissecting a cadaver or when you're giving Jimmy what he deserves. Who is Jimmy? Poor Jimmy. Oh, the veins and arteries actually are a somewhat similar color. A smaller light diffusion process is happening when we see people who are suffocating and have purple lips and fingertips. In this case, the blood is so oxygen-deprived that it turns an extremely dark shade of red. When the light diffuses through the skin of the lips or through your fingernails, it then often ends up looking very dark blue or purple. In reality, of course, blood is shockingly various shades of red, with the red color primarily coming from hemoglobin, which contains 4 heme groups. These heme groups' interactions with various molecules end up giving it the dark red or light red color that we see, usually with some caveats like carbon monoxide poisoning being lighter red when particularly oxygenated and darker red when it has less oxygen. There are some creatures that have blue blood. Rich people. For example, horseshoe crabs, whose baby blue blood is actually worth about $60,000 per gallon. Damn! This is due to a chemical found in the amebocytes? A-M-O-E-B-O-C-Y. Amebocytes. Amebocytes. Amebocytes.
Amebocytes.
Nailed it. This is due to a chemical found in the amoebocytes of its blood. When this is exposed to a potentially dangerous foreign bacterium, it will immediately coagulate around the threat, rendering it harmless without actually destroying it. This effect is near instant, and the blood can be used to detect a potential threat, even if it's diluted as much as one part per trillion. This effect is amazingly useful for detecting bacterial contamination in things like medicines and vaccines, or on medical equipment like needles, pacemakers, and numerous other items that are required to be sterile. In fact, no drug on the market today can be certified by the FDA unless it has been tested using this exact method, known as the limulus amoebocyte lysate test. This was in homage to the species of crab, Limulus polyphemus. It's by far the best way scientists are aware of for detecting whether a batch of medicine or vaccine has been compromised or not. As such, the blood of these crabs is worth a small fortune, selling for around $60,000 per gallon. If you're wondering how this blood is harvested, the crabs, I wasn't, but okay. I assumed you just killed the crabs. If you're wondering how this blood is harvested, the crabs, over 500,000 per year, are carefully picked up when they visit the shore for breeding purposes and taken in cooled trucks to certified labs where around 30% of their blood is drained, after which they're returned to the sea. Oh, that's nice. The blood cells are then separated using centrifugation. Next, the isolated cells are placed in distilled water where they will eventually burst, releasing the valuable chemical inside. After being purified, it is then freeze-dried and stored to be used for testing. Approximately 85 to 97% of the crabs harvested for this purpose survive and go on their merry way afterwards, with the crabs' blood levels returning to normal in under a week. Even with the relatively good survival rates, all of this may sound a little harsh. I don't know. We kill and eat animals every day. I'm not super worried. I've eaten loads of crabs. But there is one type of animal, besides humans, that at the least is glad this property of horseshoe crab blood was discovered in 1956 by Dr. Frederick Bang, namely the rabbit. Before the horseshoe crab blood method, LAL, of detecting microbial contaminants, a much less accurate and time-consuming system involving testing on live rabbits was used. In this rabbit pyrogen test, the rabbits were injected with a sample of the substance to be tested, so it was a bad time for them. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. That's all about blood today, and those handy tips for murder. Smash that like button if you found that useful. Smash that dislike button if... No, don't smash the dislike button. You made it all the way to the end of the video. You probably love it. Check out our wonderful sponsor, Mac Weldon. They just make the best stuff. It's linked to below. And thank you for watching.